afternoon session, which will start with Sebastian's, the final part of his talk.
Great. I hope all of you had a nice lunch. So there's only 45 minutes left. So what I'm going to do in the 45 minutes is to talk about something that's not related at all to my work, but what I'm very excited about, and that's a relatively recent technique called spectral normalization. And then we're going to look, if time permits, on one particular example. I think a particular example of applying the GAN methodology, not for generating images, but to solve another problem. And that is approximate inference, or like make progress in approximate inference. And we will use the variational autoencoder as a problem that we're going to address using GAN technology. And finally, then, hopefully, if I have time, I will talk a bit about some open research problems that I see. Good. So let's talk about spectral normalization. So if you remember, the last 20 minutes of my previous presentation have been about different ways to ensure this Lipschitz constraint holds, right? The Lipschitz norm of the function holding. And spectral normalization is a particularly elegant way of ensuring that this Lipschitz constraint holds. So the first way we had was weight clipping, right? Weight clipping surely is a poor approximation. The second approach we had was this Wasserstein-Gan GP of ensuring it holds at certain sample points. And so if we remember, the Lipschitz norm of a function was this, for a differentiable function, was the largest gradient. And spectral normalization is a paper, an iClip paper of last year, iClip paper from Miyato et al. And the idea is as follows. We want to constrain the Lipschitz norm of a function represented by a neural network, but we can't compute that Lipschitz norm. So how could we deal with it? Well, we have two choices. Usually when something intractable is there, you have two choices. You can either approximate it, so you derive a procedure which somehow is an estimate of this intractable quantity, and approximate inference, for example, is full of approximate procedures to estimate things. Or what you can do is you can bound things. So you can, instead of getting the true value, you can say, okay, I make some assumptions under which I can show that I get a value which is always, in any case, larger or smaller, depending on the direction you want, than the true value. For example, the evidence lower bound in variational inference is a lower bound on the true quantity, the marginal likelihood, the evidence that you care about. So what Miyato et al. Do is they say, we have this unknown Lipschitz norm of the function, we can't compute it, but we know that we can bound the Lipschitz norm of a function by a quantity which is related to each linear layer of a neural network. And then we have a bound, and we can make sure that this bound holds. And if the bound holds, obviously the true unknown function norm, Lipschitz norm, is also satisfying the bound. So here's the idea. We have a neural network. We have the definition of a Lipschitz form. So here's this D function, the discriminator function. We have an input, X, an image, and T is a scalar. So how are we limiting it? Well, we say this Lipschitz norm, if every layer is a linear function followed by a ReLU nonlinearity, so we make the assumption that we only have ReLUs, then we know, or what they actually show in the paper, is that the overall Lipschitz norm of the function is bounded by the product of the Lipschitz norm of each layer. So each layer is a function. The Lipschitz norm, the definition of Lipschitz norm, holds for any function, right? So this could be a single layer, no problem. So we compute Lipschitz norms for each layer, and the product of all these Lipschitz norms, which we can compute, upper bounds the Lipschitz norm of this function. Now, what's the Lipschitz norm of a layer? And it turns out that for linear layers followed by ReLUs, we have the simple relationship that the Lipschitz norm has a closed form. It is the bounded norm Euclidean input vector H, which maximizes the Euclidean norm of the output pre-ReLU. So this is just for the linear layer. So now we have something that we cannot compute, upper bounded by something that we can compute. That's the first, I think, a standard way in machine learning. If we have intractable things, we try to find bounds in the right direction. But they have something very clever that follows. And what's very clever is that they can very efficiently compute this. almost for free. And that's a non-trivial thing. So how are they going to do that? If you want to compute this quantity exactly for an arbitrary linear layer W, and the linear layer could be non-square, so W could be a non-square matrix, any rectangular matrix is valid, then what you would have to do is to do the singular value decomposition. So to do a procedure from linear algebra, I hope most of you, who has not heard of singular value decomposition? You don't need to know the procedure, you just need to have heard of it. Okay. So it's a cubic time operation you can perform on a matrix, and you get objects known as singular values and left singular vectors and right singular vectors. And this decomposes the matrix in a specific way. And if you know this decomposition, so if you take the matrix and you do an SVD in Julia or in MATLAB or in NumPy or whatever, if you do an SVD, then you get these vectors and you get the singular values. And the largest singular value is precisely this value. So that's the input direction which maximally stretches the output. Right? So if you want the largest response in the input in the output, but you're only allowed to be on the circle in the input, which point on the circle is the one that creates the largest output? And what's the stretching factor? That's the singular value. So what they do is they say, okay, this is a cubic algorithm. I mean, there's no way we want to perform a cubic algorithm on like 1,000 by 1,000 weight matrix every single learning iteration, right? This would just be not nice. So what they do instead is they say there are iterative methods similar to the power iteration for eigenvalue decomposition. There's a power iteration for singular value decomposition, which is an iterative linear algebra procedure. And what they say is, well, if we change the parameters only a tiny bit from learning iteration to learning iteration, then we can recycle the work, we can amortize the work of doing this iterative matrix algebra, and we just do a little bit of work every iteration. And over time, we do a lot of work, and we will get accurate estimates of the largest singular value. So, and when we know the singular value, then we can always take the weight matrix and divide it by this largest singular value, and then afterwards it has a norm of one, a Lipschitz norm of one. So, now when we do this, we have a Lipschitz norm of one in each layer, and therefore the product is also one. Everywhere, for every possible input. So that's pretty cool. So it's fundamentally different from the previous approximations, which evaluated the function at some points, right? Like the WGAN-GP evaluated the function at some points. Okay, so now the power method. Let me talk about so how to enforce this constraint individually. And it's the way I like to understand it is to actually write down the TensorFlow or PyTorch graph that corresponds to it. So this is a normal graph. Let's ignore the bias term. The bias term doesn't really matter. Let's ignore the bias term and just focus on the linear weight matrix. So this is a linear layer. It takes in some input. There's a weight matrix in the ice layer, and then there's some output. So what they do is they introduce another layer on top of that. Let's call it the spectral normalization layer. And the weight matrix is still at the top. So that's the object that we want to learn, Wi. And the spectral normalization layer, what it does is it maintains an estimate of the largest singular value, just like batch normalization maintains an estimate, the running estimate of the mean and the variance. And using this estimate, it takes in W and divides it by the largest singular value and produces W spectral normalized. So this is just a normal deep learning graph, right? This is a parameter you want to learn. You pass it through this layer and you get another array, but this is not learned. This is just the output of this layer. And now you do the matrix multiply. And the way it obtains this, the spectral, the estimate of the largest singular value is to perform the following operations on two extra vectors, U and V. And U has, so if you have a matrix, W is a matrix M by N, then U is an M vector and V is an N vector. So you have the input size, output size of the matrix, you have two vectors, you maintain them, initialized randomly, and you don't do any backprop here. You don't do any backprop to these vectors. So this is really just tensor operations. And so you have these two updates that you run. So a left matrix multiply divided by a left matrix multiply, so a normalization. And then you have the opposite. So V is updated this way, U is updated this way. And that's all you do. And that's a matrix vector multiply. That's not n cube. That's very fast. Right. And you don't backprop to these. So you just update them every iteration. Whenever you in the forward operation of this layer, you perform these two operations, then you perform the division, and these arrays just stay around. And after training, you can throw them away. Make sense? So I think there is some. This is really nice for the application of GANs. This is really nice for ensuring function norms. But I think the more general idea here is even more genius, which is taking an iterative procedure and amortizing it during the learning over time. So it's almost free, computationally for free to do this. So an n-cubic operation becomes almost free. And what other iterative matrix algorithms you have that you can maybe think about putting into similar amortized form? Yeah. Good question. So initially, if you initialize the vectors randomly, the singular value estimate is really bad, right? But in practice, you would use even as many as one. So the power iteration is reasonably fast convergent. You can use five or something, but I think nobody uses more than just a few. So you can, if you use very many, then you can get a convergent algorithm. At any point, you have a perfect estimate of the singular value, right? A numerically perfect estimate of the singular value if you run many, many iterations. But even just performing one operation is sufficient. Yes? Yes, indeed. So the question is, how loose is this bound? Indeed, that's a question. I will come back to that in the open research section. Yeah. The other thing I want to say, I don't have the citation in the slides. So for linear layers, this is nice. For convolution layers, there's actually a recent paper that exactly shows how to perform the SVD efficiently because the convolution kernels are very small. So you can basically do that on the convolution kernels. Not treating it as a linear operator on the whole thing, but you can make it very efficient on a small k by k convolution kernel. So so if you have for convolution layers, you can do this. Everything else in deep learning is linear. So you can do this everywhere. The only thing where it doesn't work is if you have activation functions which have unbounded Lipschitz constants themselves. So if I want to use, say, an exponential function as my activation function, then this technique may not work. Okay, so, right, okay, so here the final step that I omitted so far, this is how you get the normalized matrix from the unnormalized matrix, just by dividing with this orange quantity, so vector matrix vector product, scalar value, this is a scalar, say 4.5, and this is the estimate of the largest singular value, this is the estimate of the spectral norm. And you don't backprop to these things, so you can do as many iterations as you want, there's nothing to keep around, no arrays to keep around. Okay, great. And afterwards, you know that you have the singular value is approximately close to one. And this, I mean, they have amazing results as well. They generate class-specific ImageNet results, just like we did. I would say the fidelity is comparable. And yeah, so this is a nice technique to know about and easily applicable, easily implementable. Great. Good, then let me move on to using implicit models as building blocks. And this is going slightly away from GAN, but we will use GAN-like methods. So in particular, we will use them for variational inference. And this is based on a work we did called Adversarial Variational Base, AVB. But let me mention here at this point that the idea was in the air. It's often in machine learning that an idea is in the air. If all the ingredients are there and the problem is pressing, it's not uncommon for two or three groups to have the same idea at the same time. And indeed, that that happened. I think there are even two citations which I should have added, which also had this idea. The idea is as follows. So this is again my brilliant collaborators. The idea is to use them as variational families for approximate inference. So we will be doing elbow variational inference, elbow maximization, but instead of an explicit Q model, we will use an implicit Q model. So you all have heard of the variational autoencoder, right? Have you heard how great it is? Sure, okay. So then I can go very quickly. This is a standard way to do a latent variable model, and this is a form of most VIEs, generative models, VIEs. And there's an idea here that is to use an inference network that you have heard about, right? So normally, what you would have to do here is you have instance-specific latent variables. So every single latent every single sample has a specific latent variable. So it's not one latent variable that's shared across your whole data set, like the parameters could be, if you're Bayesian about the parameters. So variational autoencoder is not Bayesian about the parameters. But it is Bayesian about the latent variable Z. And every single instance has a latent variable. So if you want to do variational inference on what Z should be here in this quantity, what you have to do is you have to do a per sample approximate inference distribution Q. So a variational distribution Q. So the first instance in your set has its own variational distribution. The second instance has a second variational distribution, and so on. And so the idea of inference networks is simply to say that it's crazy. We would have, if you have, even if you just have 50,000 MNIST digits, I mean, nobody uses MNIST anymore. Let's say we have only 1 million ImageNet instances. We would have 1 million approximate inference distributions to keep around. So instead, let's do something different. Let's tie them all together in a new neural network that just takes an instance X, has some additional weights that we will adjust, some parameters, and directly outputs a distribution Z. So inference will consist of just doing a forward evaluation of a neural network. And so the genius idea here is, first of all, you don't have to keep all this stuff around. At test time, it's super efficient. You get a new sample, just one forward evaluation, you get the result. No iterative optimization. But the even more the genius is that if you would think hypothetically that you double your training set size by just duplicating it, then when you're finished with the first part of it and you reach the second part, you will start from scratch. Every single instance, you have to start from scratch because you don't know what it means, right? You have to run this variation inference procedure from the beginning for every single instance. Whereas here, after you have learned this model, so when you start learning and you're finished with the first set of samples, the second set of samples you already makes use of the learned information. So that's the idea of amortization. And so it improves efficiency. You have seen the elbow bound, everybody? This is my derivation of it. There's actually two derivations of the elbow. One, this is a simple one. This is the most common one. And it's good because you can always rederive it whenever you need it. It's like, this is one thing, Jensen's inequality applying here, swapping the logarithm and the expectation. That's all that matters. But the other derivation also keeps explicitly the residual around, and that's another KL divergence, and so it's more illuminating. But anyway, so we have the elbow for VIEs, and we have the autoencoder here, the VIE. We can think of these networks as being stacked together, so that's why it's called autoencoder, right? We have X being transformed to a distribution over latent variables with this encoder network, and then we have the decoder network that transforms Z into X, and the elbow to optimize it. So now what's the high-level idea of using GAN-like models? The high-level idea is this. We have two requirements of this variational distribution. The first one is we need to be able to sample from it. Well, obviously we need to be able to sample from it because we somehow need to approximate this expectation. So this expectation is over Q, so we need to sample from it, right? But the second requirement, you can see here, the second requirement is that we have to be able to compute its log density. And so what we do is to remove the second requirement. And that opens the way to implicit models, which are only samplable. And that also allows us to use very rich variational families. So we can use families that, you know, have some strange geometry. So here's the idea then. So we start with the elbow. Actually, it's most often advantageous, especially in variational autoencoders, to break up the KL term. So the KL term is just the expectation over Q of Q to P, right, of log Q divided by P. So if you break that up, it's exactly this. So the expectation is the same as the outside, and then you have the minus sign in reverse, so it would be log Q minus log P, but then with a minus, you can just flip the signs, right? So this is equivalent. And this is actually this nice paper by the Toronto group, by David Duvernay, called sticking the landing, that tells you if you stochastically approximate this expectation by sampling, as you do in VAEs, it's actually almost always advantageous to stay in this form, never to combine it in a KL. Whereas traditional intuition, if you learn about Monte Carlo methods, tells you if you see an integral that you can do it analytically, never use Monte Carlo. And there's a reason why this is better to break it up, because log Q will be proportionally equal to log P. So this serves as a natural control variable to this for the technically minded people. So there's a clear technical reason why this is advantageous. So let's look at the second term. So this is a term that somehow is problematic. This term is problematic because it involves log Q. So if we can only sample from Q, then we have a problem. We cannot evaluate the second part of the term, the log Q. So what we do instead is we introduce a discriminator function, just like with GANs, that will approximate this quantity, or the negative of this quantity. So let's pretend for a second we have this quantity. Then we could plug it in here. We can plug it in here instead of this, and we could optimize this bound. Right, so it all hinges on whether we can construct such a quantity. And indeed, using the results from FGAN, we can. We know that if we optimize the any F divergence loss, so for example, the original Jensen-Shannon objective, so this is again the GAN objective, right? We maximize it with some function class, and then we have a classifier, sigma, log 1 minus sigma, so the same GAN loss. If we solve this problem to optimality over t, and we get this t star function, then if we sample from these two distributions, prior and q, then this t star function is related to the log density ratio. So log density ratio is precisely the quantity that we needed for the KL. So that is a result from the GAN literature, from the FGAN literature, that if we optimize this first objective here, and we obtain the optimal discriminant function t, then we can derive the necessary quantity, the log odds. We can derive the log odds, whether it's for model P or Q. Make sense? Or too much formulas? I put colors in my formulas. I hope this helps. Okay, so then we can put in T star, right? And then we can optimize. So what we do then there is we do an alternating procedure. We do a few steps to get a better T, to be hopefully close to T star, and then we can do some steps on this objective, on theta and Q. So we need one more trick. We need the reparametrization trick. Did Shakir or anyone talk about the reparametrization trick? Okay, good. So it's simply a way to re-express sampling from Q. So we need to somehow get represent the Q object in a different way. And we represent it by a function z that now has an additional noise argument. And then this is a fine learning objective, which is reparametrized. So we sample no longer over z, we sample over epsilon. And whenever we need z, we plug it in. And that's a fine learning objective. So let me see where this goes. Okay, now the color explanations. Maybe they should have been in the beginning. So this is the discriminator learning objective. So this learning optimizing this learning objective over t gives us a function t which is hopefully close to t star. Okay, so that's s quantity, and the other learning objective is the elbow. So we have actually now two learning objectives, a pair of learning objectives. It's not a saddle point problem. This is different. This is, there's a name for it. Who told me about this? Okay, I forgot the name. There's a name in the optimization literature for this type of problems. You have two optimization problems, but they are tied together through a shared object. And so the algorithm will look a lot like GAN, but it is not GAN, because they are fundamentally two different goals. The way I like to think about it, to think very simply about it, we optimize some estimate of the elbow, and then we make our estimate of the elbow more accurate. Right? So that's a simple way. So we can, basically, there's no way you can overfit by doing too much work on one of these. You don't have to worry about this. You just can optimize whatever you want here, and then you optimize whatever you want here. So the algorithm here is then simply three gradient steps on the parameters of the different quantities that are involved. So the discriminator, the encoder, and the decoder. So we now have, instead of a VAE that has two things, or a gun that has two things, this is better, this has three things. Encoder, a decoder, and a discriminator. But the algorithm is just SGD, literally take a step here, take a step here, take a step here. So now experimentally, so the first thing you have to do is, this actually wasn't a NIPS paper. So NIPS papers, you have to do MNIST. I think this was an ICML paper, we still did MNIST. And the nice thing here is that indeed it gives us no longer necessarily a lower bound. We don't know, because we don't know the accuracy of our you don't know the accuracy of our discriminator function, and therefore we don't know whether our estimate of the elbow is really a lower bound. But it gives us an estimate, and also we can verify using annealed importance sampling, so separate verification, that the marginal likelihood on test set is pretty good. So we see two things here. We see that the 32-dimensional version of AVB has a better, two nuts better likelihood than the normal VAE. And we also see that using more dimension helps. So we go from minus 89 to minus 80 on whole dot dimensionality. And it's comparable with the state of the art. And you can also do samples for faces, which I don't know. VAE samples on faces somehow never look really sharp. Okay. So we also applied it to parameter inference. So this is kind of classic graphical models represented by STAN, which is a probabilistic programming language for continuous variables. And we compare that with the gold standard of Hamiltonian Monte Carlo, which is like the gold standard approximate inference method. And we compare the, we estimate the KL divergence to the true posterior. So first, graphically, what you can see here is you do Hamiltonian Monte Carlo. This is a representation for two parameters of the eight parameters, two parameters, marginal distribution, obtained by Hamiltonian Monte Carlo, run for a very long time. So this is as accurate as you can get using modern technology to the true posterior. And then if you do a full rank Gaussian variational base approximation, so this is kind of practical in the setting, is often what we do in practice, we get one of the modes. But because the mode is non-Gaussian, it actually is the best Gaussian approximation in the reverse KL sense. And with AVB, we get something that looks much closer to the true distribution. So we get bimodality, we get the heavier tails, the non-symmetric properties. And then in terms of KL, in terms of quantitative things, you know, the VB, the mean field VB, so the diagonal Gaussian tops out at a certain rate. This is log scale. The full rank is, of course, better because it has more degrees of freedom. So when you do variational base, you cannot overfit. With variational base, you really want to optimize as much as you want. And then this is log scale. That's why you see a bit of noise. But then we have two variants of adversarial variational base. This is a variance-reduced version. But both variants outperform the full rank VB. Okay, so that's just one example I wanted to give you how these F-gun business, how the gun stuff can be useful outside generating images. Maybe whenever you need a conditional distribution, a graphical model, you can put it in. Whenever you have to define a model that is hard to sample from, not hard to sample, that you have the requirement to sample from and evaluate the log likelihood, you can use this technique maybe to overcome the second requirement. And VB is one example. So this was probably the most detailed thing. So now we go to open research problems. If anyone has questions on this, yes, please. It's difficult to say. I don't think it's invariant because already the convolutional neural network is not invariant. So it's a very nice paper, actually prize-winning paper from the University of Amsterdam. So Max Welling's group. Where they showed, for example, that convolutional neural networks are not invariant, and they propose invariant networks. But because here we have a neural network which deals with the input data, so certainly not to spatial transformations. If you do element-wise transformations, if you stretch the space, I would also have to think about. I don't think any of these techniques is invariant, unfortunately. So the formal F-gun, like the F-divergences, they are invariant. You can do any transformation to the any invertible transformation to the space does not influence the F-divergence. So that's a beautiful property, just like the KL is invariant. And the reason is that you only ever compare densities using the density ratio. So if you modify the space for both densities, you have to modify the space in the same way. You stretch it maybe in one dimension by a factor of 10. That happens for both densities, and it cancels out. Other questions? There are other questions, yes? Right. Right. Normalizing flows are great. Normalizing flows, there's still a lot of research happening on normalizing flows. They are still computationally expensive, but what normalizing flows offer is really compelling. They offer a way to construct a flexible probabilistic model, which is really nicely tractable. So you can sample from it, you can compute the log density, and therefore you can use it whenever you want to use a probabilistic model. So you can use them for variational inference, you can use them as part of your model definition. You can do a lot of cool stuff with normalizing flows. So it's a very important class. So unfortunately I couldn't talk about it. I can't talk about it now with the time. I didn't prepare slides, but it's, and probably somebody else talked about this already, but there is still a very nice research effort in defining new flows, making them computationally more efficient, and showing what they can do. So they're really good. Whether they are good enough as own models, so you can say, I don't need a VAE anymore, I just do a normalizing flow, right? That is yet to be seen. So there is some initial work where people have spent a lot of effort to make them somehow work for images, but the results are still miles apart from GAN models, for example, for images. But as an ingredient, a flexible ingredient that can be used in many different situations, they are great. Yes? Right. Good question. I will come to that. I can come to part of the question in the open research part. But let's see. So discrete outputs here would mean that X is discrete. If X is discrete, everything should still work because we never ever create X by our model. So we never need to backprop. In this case, backprop through X. It's different from the GAN setting. Right, so we always, here we sample z. Z is continuous in this case. So the question would be maybe, what if z is discrete? Then maybe we have a problem here. Okay, so let me go to the open research problems, and then we can conclude. So one big problem, and I could have said this a year ago, and I could have said this 2 years ago, and I could have said this 3 years ago, is there is not a nice quantitative evaluation metric for GAN type models. So the candidates are, so the original, so for images, there is some widely accepted metric called the inception distance. What the inception distance does is really, from an evaluation point, almost heresy. It only stood the test of time because there's no better alternative available, or very few alternatives available. What the inception distance does is, it uses an auxiliary model, a classifier, that is trained on a relevant domain, say ImageNet. You train on ImageNet, and you have a classifier trained on ImageNet. You produce samples from your model, and samples are images, and you pass them through your classifier, which is fixed, you don't adjust it, and you keep a histogram over all the classes it decides. Right? So you don't need a ground truth label, you just make a histogram. It says, oh, this is a German Shepherd, this is an aeroplane, and you increase the counts. And then you evaluate a distance between the marginal distribution of your data set over the classes, so the true labels, against the histogram that you have obtained. And so if you, on average, get the right distribution over classes, you can have a perfect inception distance, which is high, so they normalize it so that you basically can have infinite inception distance, or inception score. That somehow is not complete. it has this problem that it's a sensible metric to see, it correlates with the quality that we see, but if you were to optimize for it, you would get trivial results. So it's somehow not a good metric. There are other considerations or proposals. So one is, let's use IPMs. IPMs can be applied everywhere. IPMs can be applied to probabilistic models. IPMs can also be applied to non-probabilistic models, actually. So you don't need a distribution. You can have a simple model which just outputs a constant. You can still evaluate an IPM. So it's very generically applicable. It is well defined. We have the theory. We can estimate it unbiasedly. So this is almost perfect, right? The problem with that is that, well, then you would optimize for the same IPM and you would get the best score. So somehow it ticks a lot of the boxes, except that you almost set the goalpost exactly where you want it to be, right? So if I do some kernel method or so on, I can say, okay, my model is the best in terms of kernel MMD. Well, no surprise, I trained it on kernel MMD. So there's another proposal, there's some follow-up work. So Kevin Roth and others have proposed a following game, which is interesting. So you say we both trained a gun model on the same data set. Maybe Benji, you trained a gun. I don't know if you train gun models, but let's say we both trained a gun, right? So I have a generator, you have a generator, I have a discriminator, you have a discriminator. So discriminator is a classifier. What if my discriminator can reliably distinguish your generator samples into fake or real? And does a really good job. But your discriminator fails to distinguish my samples accurately. Well, that could make the point that my generator is better, or my pair of generators and discriminators is better than yours. So now we have a pairwise comparison, and we can think about the idea of tournaments, right? So everybody brings a gun model and a discriminator, we all play a game. In the end, there's the ultimate generator-discriminator pair that wins the tournament. It sounds maybe, you know, bit non-scientific at first, but on the other hand, maybe it can be made really well defined, and there's some follow-up work. So now guns for discrete data. So discrete latent variables for gun models are not a problem. This is great. I mean, if you want to have a gun model that has a few discrete variables and maybe 100 continuous variables, you can do it. Absolutely no problem, because you only need to sample from it. You just put it in. There's no backprop happening through the discrete variables. But discrete observations are problematic. So if you want to generate text, if you want to generate class labels, binary vectors, then you have a problem with guns. And the problem is essentially that you first have to define what does it even mean to take a gradient of a discrete function. And surprisingly, this is not a problem for all the likelihood-based methods. So variational autoencoders, recurrent neural networks, other autoregressive models. They have no problem dealing with discrete observations because they never generate anything that they don't observe. Right, so they never generate data during learning from the model. And gun models generate data from the model during learning. And therefore, we don't have to perform backprops. Yeah? Right. Oh, yeah. So, exactly. Right, so there's initial work that has similar ideas here from Devon Helm at Microsoft Research in Montreal. There are a couple of things. This problem with discrete variables is not unique to guns. You have it in other areas as well, right? So, for example, if you want to have discrete latent variables in VAEs, no problem with guns. With VAEs, you have the problem. And then people have defined, so this is an intractable problem, right? It's an intractable problem. In VAEs, actually, it has a sound definition. The gradient exists and everything. It's a well-defined learning problem. It is just intractable. So how you deal with it? And then there are very simple approximations. So the first generation of these approximations were just, well, just ignore it. Let's just output something continuous and just pretend it's a continuous variable. And in the end, we round it, or we have some temperature parameters. So the straight-through estimators of this type. And other people have said, no, we can systematically relax with a Gumbel softmax. And then there are people have debiased that estimate, but it had huge variance. And then people have did a sequence of work. So, for example, the relax, rebar, concrete, sequence of works, which ultimately lead a reasonably satisfying solution. So I think it's always David Duvernay who has the best solution now to these discrete problems. So I don't know what the latest is. I think it's still rebar or a variant of the rebar estimator. But basically, if you for VIEs, there is a solution. For GANs, nobody has really gotten, to my knowledge, has gotten discrete GANs to work, to generate discrete data. Initial attempts, for example, in natural language generation using GANs are very dissatisfying compared to RNNs. So there is some... So it's an active field of research, and maybe there will be a very satisfying solution, and it will be just like a tool that we can use. I don't know. But it's an open problem. GANs for discrete data is an open problem. Whether I would encourage you to work on it, I'm not so sure. So estimation uncertainty, right? So estimation, 5 minutes, okay, great. Estimation uncertainty is the uncertainty that goes away when you have more data. That's estimation uncertainty. So when we use, when we follow the Bayesian paradigm and we keep estimation uncertainty represented by a posterior over our parameters, what naturally happens is that we have very precise results to what happens as we see more and more observations. We have precise concentration results. We know what happens qualitatively to the Bayes posterior, and we know that the right thing happens. So GANs do not have a likelihood. Therefore, GANs don't follow what's called the likelihood principle, and GANs don't have a Bayesian posterior. So there's a question is, can we define an equivalent object, a kind of a pseudo-posterior that has similar qualities, and what can we prove about this? There's a paper on Bayesian GANs. It's interesting. I wouldn't kind of... So it raises some interesting points. It basically defines a posterior by defining two conditionals, but two conditional distributions. But these two conditional distributions are not necessarily compatible. So if you have a probabilistic model, x and y joint, you can factor it in two ways, right? P of x times p of y given x, or the other way around. And when you do that from a single joint, both of these conditionals will be coherent. So they will kind of match to the same joint distribution. So what they do here is they define just two conditional distributions, but nothing ensures that these are coherent and belong to the same joint distribution. And yet somehow it still works. And so there's and so similar methods have been explored 2 decades ago, and I'm not sure where this will exactly lead, but it's an open question. Can you define, can you handle estimation uncertainty with GANs? Bounds on the Lipschitz constant. So spectral normalization, I'm a big fan of. It's efficient, it's sound, but the question is how loose is a bound? Is it, you know, a gap of 0.2 in value, or is it a gap of a factor of 200,000? We don't know. So is there a systematic way to make maybe a hierarchy of bounds, each of which takes more compute but is tighter and tighter? That would be one possible goal. So I would say a multi-layer extension. You take bounds over pairs of layers or things like that. Unfortunately, there is some very recent hardness results from the University of Leuven, which say that function norms for neural networks, of which the Lipschitz norm is one particular instance, is actually NP-hard to compute. And also, in a precise sense, NP-hard to approximate. So maybe this is kind of too much to ask for. But why not? So maybe why not have a concept, you know, like variational regularization? So for example, we had this this thing in the Wasserstein-GAN GP where we sample a point from this distribution, a point from this distribution, and we interpolate along a line, right? Why can't I keep, say, 1,000 points in the space and I actively try to find high gradient points or something and I optimize over these points placement? Maybe as a simple example of how to pose it variationally, but maybe there's something much more cleverer. So I think there's more work to be done there. 1 minute, 2 minutes? Yeah. So finally, I showed you these many divergences. There are more. Maybe there are even entire different classes of divergences. And indeed, there are these extensions, in particular Sobolev divergences, where there's an additional probability distribution entering the definition of the divergence. And this probability distribution can be, for example, the model distribution itself. And so then it strictly leaves the class of IPMs. And some theory has been shown about this in the original papers, but the advantage is we can use these more general divergences to overcome the problems, for example, of the function norm. So we can say the function norm evaluated at points of our generator distribution. And that we can approximate unbiasedly because we can always sample from our generator distribution. So this is the question, have we charted out the space of divergences? what's left and how can we actually advantageously use this. And one way to advantageously use it is to define something sound that we can prove things about that also is approximatable in a precise sense, so unbiased gradients, for example. So theory, I'm not a theory person. People have looked at generalization bounds for GANs. People have negative results. So there's Sanjeev Arora has work on how you can use the birthday paradox test. So for example, with probability one, at least two of you here in this room share the same birthday, probably close to one. And you can use the same kind of test or to test whether a GAN model is good, and it turns out it's not good, and then there's some theoretical analysis why it's not good. But I'm not a theoretician, so I trust the theory is correct. The question is always with theory, if you don't like the outcome, you can question the assumptions, and I don't know enough about the assumptions really, whether they accurately capture. Finally, I think that's pretty much it. So thank you very much. The email address is wrong.